Hello everyone, welcome back. Today, I, Shivansh Bansal, co-founder at Law Community, is here with Ms. Deepriya Snehi. She's practicing before Delhi High Court and Supreme Court of India, and we are here to know more about her journey and learn from her.
So my first question is, how did you develop an inclination towards legal research and writing?
So my first stint with legal research and writing began while I was in law school, obviously. But before that, I used to write on topics of my interest, which majorly were centering around the general knowledge criteria while I was in school. When I came to the law school, we had a first subject as legal writing in the first year. And the professor was teaching us interpretation of statutes. So I remember walking up to my professor and asking him that why are we reading interpretation of statutes when we are actually being taught legal writing. So he told us that interpretation forms a really important part of legal writing. And that's how you understand that what is the reasoning behind certain terms, how and when to interpret certain legal terms and in what fashion. So from there on, I picked on that, so legal writing constitutes a really important part of the journey of law. And that's how I developed my inclination because I started liking the subject. I like the reasoning that was behind it. And I also like the idea that every term can be used and can be seen in a very different context from what we perceive it to be. And it just doesn't have a dictionary based meaning, but meaning of a certain word just goes way beyond what we perceive it to be. Moving on from there, I remember discussing it with my contracts teacher also in law school. She had given us a question paper which was quite a lot application based, and it had a lot of questions which were not coming from the rote learning that we do to say in the law school. And since it was application based, so we were supposed to write the answers in the form of a judgment. So it was more like a judgment writing sort of an answer based questionnaire. So in that one, she told, of course, the entire batch that you'll have to frame the issues, then you will have to discuss the facts. After discussing the facts, you'll have to appreciate the evidence and so on and so forth. So that's how I figured that this writing is completely different from what we have been doing. Even blogging is completely different from what you do while you actually sit down to write for a particular legal proposition. So these little things which I didn't know and I had the curiosity to know about really pushed me forward to know and to gather more knowledge about legal writing. And that's how I developed sort of an inclination. And since it was also an uncharted territory for me, so I just wanted to know more about it. So I just kept on reading and researching on how to really get into that space where I can write and I can still get published. Of course, while you are in your first year or so, you don't really think that, you know, you want to be published in a journal per se. But since I was researching also and I was also looking forward to expand my knowledge on the subject, by that time I had understood that if I'm really working on this aspect of the legal education, then I might as well explore the areas where this might be appreciated, this sort of knowledge might be appreciated. And that's when I stumbled on a lot of journals, a lot of blog accepting websites, and I started writing for them.
So do law schools lack in promoting and training in legal research and writing among law students?
I think law schools have been doing a pretty great job of tutoring children on a lot many fronts, but I don't think we have done enough research. We have gathered enough resources yet to actually tutor students on the front of legal writing and legal research for that matter. Because this is the sort of difficulty that I also witnessed. And as and when I see some intern come to my office or whenever I am in court, that's what I have heard and I myself have faced, that we do not really have access to the practical research skill and practical writing skills, which we need to inculcate. Because you see, we are already spending 5 years of our life in a law school. 5 year law education, of course, has completely changed the paradigm of the law as it was. And of course, it has resulted in a lot many good legal scholars that we have today. But when it comes to legal research and writing, we still continue to lack that acumen that we need to have developed while we were in law school. And we continue to lack the research skills in particular. Because once you get into the field, you realize that these are the search engines that I'll have to really explore while I'm going to research for a proposition, which is required for your job or so. And it's where many of the students, they think that they lack in particularly understanding the proposition. And of course, while you're going for moot courts and you're going for essay writing competitions for that matter, you get to explore, you get to know that how you can put yourself at an advantage while using these research engines in a very intelligent fashion. But the real practical aspect that comes with it, which is identifying the keywords, you know, which are surrounding a provision. For example, if there is a provision which is related to criminal procedure and you have been given a research on that proposition, you should know certain terms related to the procedure. You should know that how and when an appeal is filed. If appeal is filed, whether revision can be invoked. If revision has been filed, can you go back to the appeal? So these are the little propositions which you only understand after you have actually gone through the practical aspect of law. And these are not the provisions which you can necessarily understand by way of books or something. So I think the task is absolutely upon law school to really show the students this side of law, where, because at the end of the day, it's all practical application. It's understandable that, of course, you need to understand the provisions and everything. But unless and until you understand that provisions actually have a real and practical application in as and when you will get into the profession, unless and until it is taught, I don't think any law student and any law curriculum for that matter is suitable as for the present needs.
According to you, how important it is for a law student or a law professional to take a part in academic writing?
I think it's really important to take part in academic writing, whether it's through participation in competitions like essay and blogging. And I think there are several journals and several blogs which have come up in a lot of law schools, just not nationally but internationally also. So it's very much important to inculcate that habit of reading and writing at the same time. Because once you get into the profession, no matter if you're getting into litigation or the corporate field or, you know, any other area of law, you will have to constantly write and read about the provisions. So unless and until you inculcate that habit of writing to actually be able to present your views on a piece of paper, you will not be able to you know, fulfill your own milestones that you have set for your own career. Also, what happens is that that is what I have noticed that DPC, which is drafting, pleading, conveyancing, the subject, in law school, it is introduced as late as in third or fourth year mostly. I think curriculum-based decision, of course, it's a curriculum-based decision, but I think it should be appreciated that if DPC is introduced beforehand in the college, so that we can get used to the art of writing, whether it's judgment or it's order or it's some sort of, an explanation as to the provision of law. Now, academic writing is nothing but, you know, just explaining and putting your views and analyzing the proposition of law in the first place. So it's as important as, if you have understood how to do legal research, if you have understood how to articulate your point of view, you might as well should have understood legal writing. And of course, it goes without saying that a lawyer has to be a good draftsman in the long run. So if one could inculcate that habit of academic writing since the beginning of the law school, I think that student is surely has a way forward and a good one in when it comes to pursuing law as a career.
So how did you map your paper publishing strategies? And what goals did you have in mind?
Actually, honestly speaking, I did not map out any publications and I did not sort of put much thought into it. My legal writing was mostly based on the contemporary writings, and I always thought that it's really important to have a voice, to really have an opinion while we are at it. And whenever some contemporary issue arose which really shook me to the core, or I thought that, you know, I need to have an opinion on this thing and I need to express it in entirety, that was the time when I started writing about certain things. So I remember firstly writing about Crimean crisis and the referendum that was conducted in the country. And I got published on, and I got that article published on Legal India, as far as I remember. And after that, I used to write, whether it was amendment in context of Section 376 of IPC, or whether it was some other international development that affected India when it comes to humanitarian law. That was actually my my instigating factor, my catalyst in the sense, so to say, that I wanted to write about only contemporary topics. Even today, I think a month back, I wrote about the contemporary development that had happened then with when I analyzed district and sessions judge order, bail order. Before that, I wrote about how the right to health actually exists as an international obligation. So I did not actually chart out, I did not plan out, and I'm more of a person who analyzes what is happening in the country or in the world for that matter, and just go about and expressing their opinion on it. That's about it.
What tips would you like to share with students and professionals who want to grow in the legal writing?
Actually, I think to master legal writing, you'll have to be a good legal researcher in the first place. And by researcher, I don't just mean you need to know how to use the search engines to your advantage or so. You need to be really analytical in the bent of mind should be really analytical, that when you read the provision, you should question yourself that why is the provision at this particular stage, at this particular chapter in a particular bare act, and why does the provision have this clause, why is it followed by this particular explanation, why does this have this particular proviso. So that's how you should approach reading any legal provision in the first place. When it comes to analyzing the international aspects of any law, you should always pick on the laws which are opposite or contrary to what as the law exists in your country, so that you can have access to other sort of opinions, and then you can arrive at a comprehensive understanding of why the particular provision is there in your country in a specific manner. After that, you need to understand that, of course, as I have already stated before, that you need to understand that there are certain keywords that you cannot dispense with. For example, if you are going to write or going to analyze a government notification, so you'll have to understand that whether it's a gazetted notification, what are the consequences of it, was the signing authority the actual signing authority, or was the authority actually delegated to someone else. Now, there is another provision, another law, which comes into being when there has been delegation of power with respect to signing of certain instruments. So when you get into legal writing, you get into analyzing a certain proposition of law, you'll also have to understand that research is a multifaceted thing. So you'll have to approach it from every corner and every angle possible, whether it's from the eye of procedure, whether it's from the eye of substantive law, whether there are underlying rules or regulations or any other sort of notifications. And once you start analyzing, once you start questioning, once you start to reason out as to why this particular section actually exists, that's when your legal research improves, because now you have a reason. Once you have identified the reason, your legal research in a way gets multiplied, and in a way presents itself in a such a beautiful fashion that you yourself will feel that, you know, you have amped yourself up for an erudite discussion. And that's the point when you will have to understand that if I can discuss, if I can back my points, if I can back my argument with these points, that's the time when you should think that you're actually ready to write up something on a certain proposition of law. Also, always frame the question of law before going forward with the legal writing, because to a reader, whoever is coming across to read your blog or your article, your journal for that matter, is always coming to find an answer. So why not present a question in the first place and then go on presenting an answer from your side? So always present it in the form of a question, which has to be followed by an analysis of the question, that why is the question, why does the question exist in the first place? So then you can analyze the question. After that, you can give your arguments to it. You might as well present opposite arguments to it. And after that, you can conclude and tell your side of the arguments and why is it sustainable in the long run. And if there are any suggestions which you might want to introduce in after analyzing, which you found out after analyzing the provision of law, that is something that you can actually put forth from your side. What also happens is that many of the law students, they do not understand that it's really important to ornament your legal writing in a certain manner. By ornamenting, I mean that you can introduce a lot of judgments which are not particularly on that point of law that you have taken up, but they in a way interpret the terminology that have been used in the proposition of law that you have taken up for analyzing. For example, there is section 157 of Criminal Procedure Code of 1973, in which the report that has to be submitted by the police to the magistrate is mandatory, and it has to be done forthwith. Now, the usage of the term forthwith has been done in the section. So when a student would be analyzing the section or would be analyzing some contemporary judgment on the subject, he would take up maybe the proposition that what are the contours of Section 157, how does it operate, and what is an occurrence report. He might end up analyzing these terms and he might end up picking judgments directly related to Section 157. But what can you do in such a case is that you can also go a step forward and analyze if there are any judgments on the subject interpreting the term forthwith. So when you have picked on that word, you can now analyze the judgments as to it, and then you can just direct your writing as to how the interpretation of Section 157 can be done in a different way, in a manner that the courts have interpreted. That also exists, but now if read in a particular context, if read with reference to a particular word, you can just mold the direction of your entire writing in context of that interpretation, which would of course make your piece really unique and distinguishable when a reader comes on to reading your writer.
Do you think that Indian policies have been successful in catering to the health needs of its citizens during pandemic?
I think there have been a lot of policies which have fared really well when it came to handling the pandemic. But there are also inherent lapses which we could have identified and which we could have fixed earlier. But they haven't been fixed so far. I think there are four or five categories where we are still dabbling between fixing the situation and letting the situation getting completely out of hand. Whether it's test, it's distribution of food, it's providing for shelter homes, then the provision for public distribution systems, then the availability of beds. These are certain things that policy had been introduced on these fronts, but we still need to identify the bottlenecks and really need to cater to these things. First of all, there is this ratio of test in proportional to the positives that are coming out after the test. So what's happening in the country is that there are 7 to 8 principal states which are reporting, and which are reporting in entirety as to who are the patients of the coronavirus and who are the patients who had actually turned out to be positive but now have been cured. But the inherent problem in identifying these numbers is that it's only the ratio of these 7-8 states which is coming across in the news and which we know as of today. Of course, India has developed a 2 lakh capacity of testing, which is a really commendable feat if we compare to the scenario in which we started. But these 2 lakh states are only been conducted in these 7-8 major states. And for the rest of the states, we do not actually have the actual data. So we cannot really say whether the situation has really been fixed because of the policies, or we are just too ignorant to take stock of the situation that's prevailing in the country. Secondly, what has happened is that, of course, the patients, the non-coronavirus patients who need immediate attention, for example, the patients of diabetes or tuberculosis for that matter, are the patients who require constant attention, who require constant diagnosis from the doctors. But what has happened is that there is no dedicated hospital till date. There are no dedicated facilities where we can place patients. So, of course, the non-coronavirus patients will have to be in the same hospital as of the coronavirus patients, who are now being subjected to the most vulnerable of the disease. So, and that's the reason that we are converting hotels or dharmshalas for that matter into the treating facilities. But I think if there had been some dedicated centers specifically for the disease, then we might have avoided subjecting these vulnerable groups who are not yet there from getting into the risk of being pushed into the hospitals, same as where patients of coronavirus are located. Also, we haven't seen this particular pandemic in a way as it was. What our strategy has been so far is that the problem has arisen and now we are going forward with it to fix it. We did not envision the extent that this pandemic could cause. And since we did not envision it in the first place, we did not have the infrastructure. We did not have the right people to cater to at the right time. So the strategy that we are employing in our current time is that we are trying to just rectify the damage still today without envisioning as to what and how the damage is panning out. Of course, there have been a lot of things like public distribution system has been really good. But again, when it came to containment zones, what actually happened was that this provision for PDS was informed to everyone. But the actual distribution in some of the districts started after the 15 days of such declaration of the notification. Now, for the first 15 days, these people who were residing in containment zones and who actually were the real recipients of this PDS system were not able to obtain food. So that, of course, led to a huge UN cry. Of course, nobody can survive without having food for 15 days in a go. So that was something that bureaucracy should have looked after. Apart from this, of course, we are expanding on our testing abilities day by day and looking into the contemporary times, also having the trade and economy going downhill. We actually are really working hard towards catering to the needs of the people. But despite that, there are certain problems which have been happening when it comes to execution of the policies, so to say. And the results that we expected out of it are not actually reaching the beneficiaries which we would have envisioned in the first place. Also, in the recent, give due regard to the migrant crisis that had happened recently. And it was only expected that these are going to be the bunch of people or the bunch of group that is going to be most affected by it. Because, of course, we who are privileged enough to sit in our homes and still study or maybe work from home, for us, it's not that big of a problem. But for people who were regularly going out and whose source of wages was only regular sort of work, that being replaced and not being provided shelter homes and everything, that of course have caused a real loss to these migrants. Government tried coming up with sort of policies and also with implementation of certain good aspects of labor laws here and there, but it did not serve the purpose that well. And of course, then the government had to withdraw. So I think we made the policies with an objective that we will be able to cater to the demands of these vulnerable groups. But we did not envision that this pandemic is going to last this long and is going to result in the breaking of the social structure as such. So had it been the case that we would have envisioned and we would have strategized, then of course we would have come out better. But the situation as it stands today is that we need to be really aggressive on our execution. We really need to be aggressive on our testing. And of course also understand that how can we accommodate these vulnerable groups in our day-to-day lives when we have understood that this pandemic is going to last for a lot longer than we had expected in the first place.
Do you think UFDA anti-terror law is arbitrary and against human rights, or does it still hold ground in sensitive and violent times like these?
I think UAPA as a law is really actually a draconian legislation, and I'm sorry if that seems like a dramatic word to say in respect of a legislation, but I think that was not the purpose that UAPA was meant to serve in the first place. It's understandable, and it's completely deducible also at this point that every anti-terror law has to be really stringent in order to put a stall on terrorist activities or unlawful activities for that matter. But if you look at anti-terror law worldwide, and if you analyze the sections or the provisions of such law, even internationally, you'll get to know that these are the legislations which are so perfectly worded that there is no scope for the investigating agencies. There is no scope left for the police authorities, for that matter, to take the law in their hands and interpret it according to their needs. Whenever an anti-terror law is being used or is being imposed on a person, the law is structured in a fashion that it is not ever loosely worded. Whereas if you look at UAPA, the sections are not just loosely worded. The sections have overlapping interpretations, and they do not circumscribe, or they are not particularly in line with the already penal legislations that we have in the country, for that matter, which is IPC. So, for example, if you take up whatever is being covered under the Terrorist Act, under UAPA, terrorist activity under UAPA, it states that whoever engages in any sort of activity which puts integrity and unity of the nation into question, and all sorts of these acts. So it basically is very loosely worded, because A, there is not a specific act which has been identified, and B, it just not only classifies terrorist organization as being indulged in terrorist activity, but also members associated with it. Now, here comes the catch for the investigating authorities, because there is no way, there is no particular fashion in which we can really identify as to who are the members who are associated with terrorist activity, whether we'll have to look into their previous criminal record, whether we'll have to trace their phone calls, to trace what sort of criminal network they were part of. Like, how do we go on about categorizing the people who have been associated with terrorist organization? There is no as such line, regulation, or anything of that sort in the act itself. And there is no way that you can identify that, okay, this person happens to be a terrorist because he has been associated with a particular terrorist organization and has been carrying out such activities. There is no such way that you can identify. Secondly, there are provisions related to conspiracy. And of course, we know conspiracy as a law is really settled. And it specifically sets out that you don't need to do an overt act for you to be charged under the count of conspiracy. But again, when it comes to UAPA, it does not specifically state, because if it had to be a general legislation, if it had to be some sort of a general provision, it could have been very well governed by IPC, where there are provisions related to criminal conspiracy, unlawful assembly, and we have got all sorts of provisions already. But if you're making a general, if you're making a specific legislation on that front, and if you are categorizing particular activities, specific activities, for it to be governed under UAPA, then it had to be really specific that what sort of conspiracy, what sort of unlawful assembly has to be charged under UAPA for that matter. But it remains completely loosely worded on that front. Also, the legislation in itself specifically states that the bail provisions which have been enlisted under criminal procedure code are the ones that are going to be governing the bail for the matters of UAPA. Now, if you, and this is something that everyone is aware of, that bail is an exception, it's not a rule. So that means if a person has furnished the bail bond and if he is sought, if he has been a citizen who has observed his duties but now has been booked under crime, so under some criminal offense, then that person in a first go is looked at as a citizen who is catering to his duties, and he's looked at as a suspect, not as an accused in the first place. And that's what the entire underlying reason for the bail to be an exception is in the first place. Bail to be a rule is in the first place. So what happens is when you have yourself used bail of bail as has been provided under criminal procedure code to be acceptable under UAPA, then it has to be treated that way. The principles cannot be dispensed with. The reason behind principle continue to exist. So why not under UAPA when you have actually placed the specific provision in the act? Also, what happens is that when it comes to the criminal procedure, which is governed as per the code of 1973, when it comes to that, you have certain time limits as to the filing of the charge sheet, as to the retention of a person in police custody or judicial custody for that matter. But when it comes to UAPA, there is no provision as such. There are no time limits as such. So it has happened, and it has been happening that many of the prisoners who have been booked under UAPA, they continue to go through just the initial stages of trial and continue to be in jail for a matter of 5 years until they have made their first appearance in the court. So I think that's really unjustified for a legislation. That's really unjustified for an investigating authority in the first place to book some person and then directly let them go to jail and then, just let them stay there for a time of 5 years, which counts as a lot because most of the penal provisions, if you read through, which exist in the country, most of them have punishments for 3 years or so. So if in the initial stages of trial under UAPA, you're keeping one person for a time gap of 5 years, for a country like India, that's a lot. And without there being any particular time set there, I think it's really unjustified. And even it's a severe violation of human rights. So I think the legislation, of course, it was amended in 2019. Before that, it has gotten amended on several occasions. But it hasn't really served the purpose that it was trying to bring, and has rather become a sort of mechanism for the investigating authorities to really stretch and book whosoever comes across as being out of line and engaged in an unlawful activity, which of course has not been specifically specified in the legislation. So it continues to be a draconian legislation, so to say, and needs inherent fixing when it comes to its implementation.
So how do you balance your interest in legal research and writing with your litigation practice?
I think there is no balancing required on that front because both of these fields are intertwined. If you are practicing, you'll have to draft petitions, you'll have to draft applications, and legal writing is something which you, of course, have acquired by the time you are into the profession and you're actually practicing. So I don't have to really find out any sort of balance, if at all there has to be, because I think balance is a myth, and you will have to have be focused on a certain area while you are at it, and then be focused on certain other area while you are at it. So if I am writing for a blog or an article or a journal, then I just focus and research in a better fashion while I'm at it. And if I am practicing, and if I'm appearing before the court, and if I have to draft while making my appearances, then I'm just focused on that part of the life. So that's how I just keep on mixing my writing with the profession. That's how I conduct it.
What life lessons have you learned from your professional journey as a litigant lawyer?
I think for the students and for the listeners here, actually I'm too young to actually give any life lessons here. But from my side, I'll just say that this is the field of law in which you will, which will provide you with the utmost satisfaction at the end of the day. Now, I'm not saying that other fields of law might not. But for me, that's what I think, that, and this is, there is a very clear saying from one of the authors of The Atomic Habits, James Clear. He states that many people, they engage with an activity for 2 hours or so. Then they hop on to the next activity for the next 2 hours, and so on and so forth. Because most of the people do not have anything to do for 16 hours with actually getting engaged in it and actually deriving results out of it. I think litigation just fulfills that criteria, where you are putting 16 hours of your day, and it's something to look forward to, because you will eventually, at the end of the day, reap the benefits out of it. Now, I know it's, for an outsider, it would seem like that you have merely appeared before the court, or you have merely obtained a one-page order. But behind that one-page order, or behind that one appearance, there goes a month's preparation. And it's something that once you have put in that amount of effort, and once you have gone through the trials and tribulations of research and writing, and then articulating with your seniors, or with your peers for that matter, and then arriving with an order in your favor, that's something which is really fulfilling for a litigation lawyer, to so to say. And it's not just about money that you are going to earn up at the end of the day, because as young lawyers, I think the major setback of litigation is that you don't get to earn much in your initial years. And even at the later stages of your profession, it is more like a service rather than finding out how and the way and the whereabouts of making money. So for the litigation, for the people who are entering into the field of litigation, I'd say that this is sort of a service industry. And if you need something to work on relentlessly, and if you want some sort of purpose that after which you will feel fulfilled at the end of the day when you are crashing down on your bed, then I think this is a field to go for. And obviously this is something that one should always take with a good stride, with an exuberance, with an amount of fervor, because once you will appear in court, and once you get to hear the words that, okay, order has been passed in your favor, that's the day when you will realize that your litigation practice is worthy of your time, of your mental space. And that's my learning from this particular profession, and that's what I would pass on to the juniors who are entering into the arena, that keep putting your best foot forward, and once you will get the benefits out of it, then you will understand that why this is the best field of law to venture out into.
So lastly, I would like to ask, how do you think an organization like Law Community can benefit the legal fraternity? And what innovative steps do you expect from this community?
I think Law Community as a platform is a really commendable feat on that front, because our world has changed. Our world is no longer more in terms of physical appearance, but it's more on in terms of social presence now. And what used to happen before is that there were a lot of courses and there were a lot of workshops happening around in the physical capacity, but most of the students, and while I was also in college, if I had my classes tomorrow, I wouldn't be able to attend the workshop or the coursework if it's happening somewhere else in another part of the country. And of course, then I had limited resources at my accessibility. So I think this is a really commendable platform to begin with. And providing for coursework, providing for such talks, which could, you know, really provide with resources to the students out there, to the young professionals out there. I think it's a really great job, and not many can take up that task and continue with it, because it's really easy to begin anything in the first place, but it's equally tough and non-sustaining to actually go forward with the idea and keep on doing that, and that too without any funding involved. When you are students, and most of you are students in the first place. So I think that's a really great initiative on your part to go ahead with it. I think a regular sort of portal where you can provide for courseworks, where you can conduct discussions on the contemporary laws that are coming up or the laws that are evolving. If you can sort of develop that portal where people are engaging in discussions, where seniors and the peers likewise are engaging in discussions, presenting their views on the contemporary legal developments. If that sort of thing we can develop by these sort of online platforms, then I think there is a long way to go, and that's the best way forward. So I think Law Community that ways has been doing a great job. And thank you guys for providing a lot of people these sort of resources and opportunity to have access to legal education in its best manner and best fashion possible.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for having such an insightful interaction with us. And it is definitely going to benefit a lot of young minds. We are delighted to have a time with you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.